Close one. Even though Phillip Rivers threw four interceptions, they had a chance to win it in the final moments of this game. Chiefs would hold on. They're now 7-4 in this game. The Chiefs very much alive to take control of their division.
Yes, they are, Nate. And joining us now is one of the most successful young executives the NFL has ever had. He's a two-time Executive of the Year winner. He was named Executive of the Decade. And most importantly, he's a three-time Super Bowl champion. It's my pleasure to welcome to our show former NFL GM, Mr. Scott Pioli.
All right! Hey.
What's up, Scott?
Well, first of all, young executive?
That's right.
Well, you were talking about the success. I was young when I had some success. Now I'm an old man.
No, you're not.
That's why I'm hanging out with you.
Doing great. Patience plays very well in this crowd.
Yeah.
You were most recently with the Atlanta Falcons in their front office, and we just saw this two-win turnaround where they beat the Saints and they beat the Panthers. You know those guys in that organization and the players very well. What did it mean to you to see the last 2 weeks for Atlanta to turn this thing around?
It meant a lot because there's a lot of people there who still really care about, obviously, DQ, Thomas, Mr. Blank, and a lot of the players, you know, because I was there when they brought in a lot of those guys. So it feels good because when you see people not succeeding in this industry and you've been a part of it and you know what that feels like yourself sometimes, it's been really cool to see them coming back right now.
Now, speaking of the Falcons, with that turnaround, do you think that's enough to keep this group together? Because people were calling for some jobs with all of that talent and them not fulfilling expectations. Now, all of a sudden, winning two games in a row, do you think they can keep this unit?
A couple things. I think they can. I think if they win out or come close to winning out, that there's a chance that people stick around. And again, I hate to speculate because it's just a horrible life to be in because I've had that happen with me.
Right.
You know what, Nate, you used an interesting word that I often worry about, expectations.
Yep.
And I think one of the most important things you can do as an organization is try to manage expectations. I think that the expectations may have been too high. Not that this isn't a good football team, but they may have been unrealistic. Mm. So I think maybe moving forward, there's a lesson in this for everyone, not only the Falcons, but with every other team. Manage expectations.
Yeah.
You got a hell of a resume, Pioli. You really do. I'm telling you, graduate assistant at Syracuse all the way to Super Bowl championships. But of all the things that jump out, you work with Bill Belichick, both in Cleveland and in New England championships.
And the Jets.
17
years.
The whole experience. We're as curious about Belichick as anybody. What is the Bill Belichick experience like for you to work with him?
It was incredible. You see, I had a unique experience because I met Bill when I was in college, right? I was still a junior in college playing college football. We met through a mutual friend. So when I went to work with him in Cleveland, when he started, I was the head coach of Cleveland. You know, I was one of the infamous slappies, as we were known as.
Yep.
And it was a unique experience because I was able to work with him in a very, again, from a unique perspective. Hmm. We worked together, but we were friends. So during that time, yes, he was my boss in Cleveland. Then when we went to the Jets, he was the defensive coordinator. I was the director of pro personnel. We had an office that had a door between us. So I got to know a very different Bill than a lot of other people knew. It's a lot different than what it looks like.
What is he like?
He's a regular guy.
Yeah.
He's a normal dude. And I think he does some things intentionally because here's the thing about Bill. Bill's main job is to win football games. That's what he was put on this earth for, was to be a father and a football coach.
Okay.
And all he wants to do is win games. So a lot of what he does, he builds this wall around to make sure that he wins games.
Mm.
He makes his promise to every single team, every player on his team, that everything he does is going to be about winning football games. So sometimes when he gives you guys, which I'm sure he gives it to all of you, a little bit of that media off, it's not personal with Bill. He's not that personally disrespectful. He's doing everything he has to do to win football games.
I've always felt that way, but take me inside, what you said, walls? Take me inside those walls, that fortress up in Foxborough. If you were to give one lesson to current teams based off what this squad has done, the Patriots, over the last 20 years, what's the one lesson
from a
front office perspective?
Here's what it is. It's culturally, and it goes back, again, I listen to a lot of people who tell a story of what that is that have never been there, or they worked there for a very short time or weren't there at the beginning. It started 20 years ago with a culture of a group of people that went there with Bill, who set the tone, but he surrounded himself with people who believed, right? Go back to the Bill Parcells thing. Parcells would go different places. Every time he went, he brought his tribe with him. There were no cracks in the foundation.
Okay.
There was nowhere for anyone to deviate from what the plan was and what the culture was.
Not easy.
When Bill went to New England this time, he went with a group of people who were amazing. One of his most important lieutenants, Ernie Adams, who's a person we all know to see. Bears Najarian, who's a very underrated master within that organization. He was Bill's PR guy and taught Bill a little bit about PR, someone that Bill trusted around PR. Then he had Romeo Crennel, myself. There was a group of us that went up there. Charlie Weiss. I don't want to forget everyone. Yeah. Anyone. Pepper Johnson. Bill went up there with a group of people that all believed in what he believed in, and there were never any cracks in the foundation, and all of us went out. There was, when things got tough, no one ever deviated. No one ever said, oh, I got to think about my job. You know, I got to save myself. Okay. There were no survivalists amongst that group. We all went up there together, and part of what Bill was able to accomplish was because he was and is a tremendous leader, and he surrounded himself with people that wanted to do things the way that he wanted to do them.
Tremendous. Really quickly, because we're going to wrap the segment, but so many people look at you as a mentor. One of them is Katie Sowers, the assistant coach with the 49ers. What's your connection to Katie and really her legacy that she's going to leave?
So Katie, as you know, is now in her third year coaching full-time for the 49ers. Katie was our daughter's fifth grade basketball coach in Kansas City.
Seriously?
And it's just, swear to God, she was coaching our daughter, and I was the GM at the time, and she loved football, was very into football. She heard a little bit about how much how much work I do in the equality area. And she started asking a lot of questions, and she wanted to know a lot about football. She told me she was playing for the Kansas City Titans at the time, which is real ball.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if any of you have seen WFA football.
Yeah.
It is real ball. And we just got to know one another. We kept in touch. And then after a couple of years at the Falcons, I was able to convince DQ and Thomas to let us bring in a woman as part of our Bill Walsh Diversity Council, or Bill Walsh Coaching Fellowship Program. And there you go. She came in for that summer, but you know, I kind of had to work Thomas a little bit because we would hire a personnel intern every year.
Yeah.
And it usually came from the personnel department.
Of course.
But Katie was in coaching. She had worked for Kyle and Raheem on the offense. So when we were done, I looked at Thomas and said, you know, Thomas, the most qualified person we got that knows the ball best and the hardest worker is Katie. I remember looking at me and said, you set this whole thing. And she came and she spent the year with us in scouting. And then when Kyle went to the 49ers next year, he hired her
as a coach.
Yeah, she's amazing. She's an amazing person, an amazing story. She's just incredible. A dear friend.
Good stuff.
More to come.
You're not leaving.
Well,
I have more Patreon. You know,
there's got to be. I heard there's going to be breakfast. Where are the snacks?
We got fake bagels.
Yeah, animal crackers. That's what I have for breakfast. I'll get you some during the break.
There you go, Scott.
This is real. No, it's not.
Scott, I want to ask you about Tom Brady because you scouted him. I need to know how much longer he's going to be playing. Don't answer that now. We'll be back with Scott Pioli next.
Good stuff.
I mean, is he going to go?
Nothing but the best here.
I'm sorry?
Is he going to go to 45?